Well, good morning. Good to be with you this morning as we gather together. I know it's a little rainy out there, but we're glad that if you're inside that you're dry, or at least drying off. And if you're outside, we are glad that you're here. And if you're on the video, watching through the video, we're glad you're tuning in through the YouTube video. So thank you for being here this morning. Let me just read a short passage of Scripture, and then we'll begin with prayer. Let me start with an announcement. First of all, announcement. On the table in the foyer, there's two locations. We have the new material, the guidepost, the daily bread, all the materials that we have, those are available, and also Sunday school books. And so if you're a teacher or a student for Sunday school, I know we're not meeting together for Sunday school, but we do have the books, and we've got them. They're on the table in the foyer, and also they're in the room across from my office in the education building. So you can go over there. All the teachers' manuals are in the education building in that room across from my office. It's over there. Everything's laid out on the table. Everything that's in here is also in that education building. So if you, during the service or after the service, if you'd like to go over there and see what's over there, or on your way out, we have some here in the foyer as well. And I encourage you pick up that literature. There's a mature living that for the senior adults, but also I forget what the home life, I believe, is for the younger couples. I'd encourage you, or younger adults, I would encourage you to pick those up. Matter of fact, I read the Mature Living as well. I mean, there's a crossword puzzle in there you can usually do, stuff like that, you know, good stuff, right? And there's great articles. You don't necessarily have to be a senior citizen for some of those articles to apply. So I encourage you. I get those magazines, I read those magazines, and so I encourage you to do as well. And there again, there's also literature to help you with your Bible study. So in the foyer, on the table, on the way out, on the left-hand side, also, once again, in the room, the Sunday school room across from my office, the first room on the right, in the education building next door. So let's give you a reminder of that. In Isaiah chapter 32, verses 1 and 2, it says, "Behold, a king will reign in righteousness, and he will be like a hiding place from the wind, a shelter from the storm, like streams of water in a dry place, like the shade of a great rock in a weary land." Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have given us this rock. You have given us this shelter. You have given us this king, and it is Jesus Christ. Lord, that we can come to you in these storms of life. Lord, the storms that we face every day, the storms that come and go, that, Lord, we have a refuge that is in you. Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, we just pray that you would be glorified this day as together we come together to worship and to hear from you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. If you would stand with me as we sing hymn number 28, "To God Be the Glory, To God Be the Glory." We're going to sing all three verses.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
On the second verse.
Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
And on the last,
great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. but purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our victory, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen. Just remain standing. We'll sing, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder. Can you claim that today? When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Amen. We'll sing all three verses.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Second verse.
On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather over on the golden time, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
And on the third.
Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Amen. You can be seated this time as we have our missions moment.
So many times people come in and they are so sick already that there's just nothing that I can do to help them. We see a lot of death here, and I know even for the volunteers, especially the medical students that aren't used to seeing death, that it can really wear on them. And it gives us opportunity to really talk about, you know, our mortality and why we're really here. And it's not just the humanitarian effort, but sharing the gospel and the best news of all, and that is that Jesus came and died for us. I pray that I will have boldness to speak with my patients about the good news. But with that said, it is encouraging when I do have post-operative patients that are doing very well and that are healing and are smiling back at me because they feel so much better.
So right now I'm on daddy duty, because Heidi is in the operating room up at the hospital doing some surgeries. Kind of that give and take in a marriage. We both pitch in so that the job can get done.
Please pray for our entire family as we live in this area. Pray that God will give us wisdom, He'll give us patience. We're sharing our lives with others, looking for opportunities to share the gospel. We're doing our jobs in cross-cultural settings. And at the same time, we're discipling others. And it really just takes our entire family to pitch in and to make it happen, to get the job done. And so we would just love to have your prayer support in those ways.
So this is one of my patients that I did an amputation that are like in and she's been such a blessing to me. She gets to go home today. There's one patient in particular that I did an amputation on her leg, and each day when I saw her, her face just lit up and smiled, and I tried to encourage her and pray with her, even read some Bible stories to her. She's currently still in town, but not in the hospital, and I took the baby to go and visit her today, and I hope in the next couple days to be able to return and really share the gospel with her and to read more of the Bible. I know that she and her family are Muslim, but I pray that God will open her eyes to the truth. I pray that God will soften the hearts of my patients so that they will be ready to hear the gospel and ready to accept the gospel.
Amen. One of our IMB missionary couples, Hone, I believe is how you pronounce her name, H-U-A-N is how it's spelled, and so obviously she's a doctor there in Africa and working with the patients there, and her husband is a church planter who's working in the local churches to train up pastors to reach the people there in Africa. So as we just take a season of prayer, an opportunity for you to come before the Lord, to come before Him, to confess, to repent, to praise, to worship, whatever it may be, to lift up the needs of others in our church and our community, and also the needs of our missionaries. And so we're just going to have just a few moments of a season of prayer, individual prayer, and then I will end that time with a corporate prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the Hone family, and Lord, for what the work that they are doing there in Africa. And Lord, we just pray that you would just continue, Lord, to bless them and provide for their needs. And Lord, may we ourselves see those around us that are lost. Lord, you have called us to stay here, Lord, you have not called us to not go out and to reach. Lord, we are all missionaries if we have the knowledge and the salvation that is found in Jesus Christ. And Lord, may we be missionaries in our own field. Lord, we just thank you for all the blessings that you have poured out on us, Lord, that you are a good God who loves us and loves the people of Africa and the people of those villages where these families are ministering. Lord, you have loved us so much that you've given us your Son to die for us. Lord, may we be a people of the gospel message. Lord, prepare our hearts this morning as we come before you, the Lord, the stillness of the hour. Lord, as we dedicate this time to hearing from you. Let your Spirit do its work within us. And Lord, that we would say that you are such a great God. Lord, how great is our God. Well, we thank you in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. If you would stand once again as we sing hymn number 5, How Great is Our God.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And all will see how great is our God! Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end,
beginning and the end. The Godhead, three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Amen. Wonderful, merciful Savior. Wonderful, merciful Savior. Hymn number 162. We'll sing all three verses.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Father, we thank you that you are the one who gives healing and grace. Lord, we need your healing. We need your grace this hour, this day. Lord, we just pray that your healing and grace would come through your word. Lord, we know that your word is powerful. And Lord, as we begin to open up your word, we just pray for the work of the Holy Spirit to be done in our lives. Lord, the healing and grace that our hearts are hungering for. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated this time. Turn to John chapter 8. John chapter 8 is where we're going to be at this morning, verses 1 through 11. Hopefully you have an outline in the parking lot. If you received a worship packet, there should be an outline in there with a couple blanks to fill in. There's a meeting in here that's available on our website. You can download that. Hopefully you did that prior to coming. If not, if you have a piece of paper somewhere, the notes will be on the overhead as well, given there. So John chapter 8. John chapter 8 is where we're going to be at the first 11 verses. Jesus gives it to her is the title of the message this morning. My grandfather, my granddad on my mom's side, my granddaddy Benny Shirouse, he had a automotive and truck repair garage over on the east side of Gainesville. Years and years ago, back when the east side of Gainesville was kind of the new side, things were moving out towards the east side of Gainesville, and he had a garage out there, and I don't know exact years, I guess the 1950s and 60s is when it was, and my Uncle Jimmy, usually the Uncle Jimmy stories have a totally different direction they go in, but this is, if you've ever heard of Uncle Jimmy's story, love my Uncle Jimmy, he's got some great stories. But he was telling me one time about working in his dad's garage. He was working in my granddad's garage there on the east side of Gainesville, and there was a woman who came in, and her car was on the wrecker. And the car would not go, the transmission. Something was wrong with the transmission. And so they brought the car in, pulled it into the garage there, and one of the mechanics slid underneath the car, looked at the transmission, and there was something missing. There was a cotter pin missing from the linkage. In other words, you could try to put it in drive all you want, but it wouldn't go into gear because one pin was missing and the linkage was not connected. And so the mechanic slid out from underneath the car and told my granddad, he said, listen, here it is. The cotter pin is missing. He said, this is a 30-second, 5-cent repair. He said, but we got her. He told him, and my uncle was telling me the story. He said, here was the term that was used. He said, hang them high, Benny, hang them high. What's he talking about? Let her have it. We can tell this woman that her transmission is so tore up, we're going to have to rebuild this thing, cost hundreds of dollars, take several days to do it. And she'd have never known the difference. My granddad said, okay. He got his creeper out. He slid underneath the car, put another cotter pin in, fixed the linkage, and backed the car out and told the lady, listen, you don't owe me a dime. It's just a pin fell out. Have a good day. It's the difference of what could have been versus what actually was. It could have been taking advantage of this lady and having a costly, expensive repair that was really no repair at all. Or the truth and giving this lady just a 5-cent pin, 30 seconds worth of labor, and just sending her out the door as a happy customer with a mechanic who told the truth. What could have been versus what was. That's what we see in this passage this morning. What could have been as the woman who is caught in adultery and brought before Jesus. We see what could have been, but then we also see what really was. It's a beautiful story that we see. It's a beautiful passage that we read. In some of your translations, I just want to briefly note this, and if you have any more questions, we can talk about this later. In some of your translations, it may have some brackets or it may have a note that says something about this passage and the early transcripts. And there is some debate about this passage, but the debate is not whether or not it's biblical. or whether it belongs in the Bible. Some manuscripts had it after chapter 7, verse 36. Some manuscripts had it after chapter 21, verse 25 of John. Some gospel manuscripts actually had it in the Gospel of Luke after chapter 21, verse 38. Some manuscripts didn't have it at all. But over 900 manuscripts had this passage in there. So there's no doubt in my mind that this is the Word of God. But also, I believe, and we're going to see over the next 2 weeks, really this is kind of a two-part deal, that we're going to see how much this fits in right here. And so I believe, there again, there's no doubt within my mind that this is the infallible, inerrant Word of God. And so, and we're going to preach it that way. And most translations do have it in there. And so if you don't, then there's something wrong. But anyway, there it is. It's right there. So to kind of give you some background. Remember the background. Last week, John chapter 7, we were in John chapter 7. And Jesus makes this statement. He goes to the Festival of Booths. And he makes this statement. On the last day, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. And whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. And remember the impact of that statement that was made as the priest was pouring out an empty jar that had no water in it on that last day, saying, there is one coming who will satisfy your thirst. There's one coming who will rain down the things of God from heaven. And that's when Jesus stands up and says, here it is, boys. It's fulfilled right here. If you're thirsty, come to me. I am the fulfillment. I am the one who can fill that jar with the waters, the water of the Holy Spirit. Well, to kind of get us caught up into where we're at, if you look there in chapter 7, verse 32, kind of going back just a little bit, it says, the Pharisees heard the crowd muttering these things about him, and the chief priests and Pharisees sent officers to arrest Jesus. And so there again, the Pharisees and chief priests, they sent officers to go arrest Jesus. Drop down to verse 45, John chapter 7, verse 45. Well, the officers, they heard what Jesus had said. They came back to the chief priests and Pharisees, who said to them, why did you not bring him? They sent them to go arrest him. They come back empty-handed. So what is it that they have to say? They say, verse 46, the officers answered, no one ever spoke like this man. And the Pharisees answered them, have you also been deceived? Have any of the authorities or the Pharisees believed in him? So they're saying, here's the litmus test. Do we believe in this guy? And if you don't, if we don't, neither should you. Look at verse 49. He says, but this crowd that does not know the law is accursed. They're going to use the law here in just a moment to try to get some people in trouble. Verse 50, Nicodemus, remember him? John chapter 3, comes to Jesus at night. Nicodemus, who had gone to him before and who was one of them, said to them, does our law judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what he does? So here Nicodemus is trying to even help Jesus out and saying, hey, listen, guys, I know you want to arrest him and kill him, but don't we even just need at least to hear what he has to say? Doesn't our law say that we should do that? So we see Nicodemus is starting to come around to Jesus. We saw his first encounter in John 3. This is the second notation of Nicodemus in the scriptures. There'll be one later on. Verse 52, they replied, are you from Galilee too? Search and see that no prophet arises from Galilee. And so here they were, they're saying, what are you, his cousin, his friend? You go to school with this guy or something, Nicodemus? Are you from Galilee as well? Do you know this kid? So who are you? Go and look the scriptures. The scriptures will tell you no prophet ever came out of Galilee. Well, they didn't know their scriptures themselves that well because the prophet Jonah came out of Galilee. But what they were saying is that there's no Messiah who comes from Galilee. That's where we pick up in verse 53. If you would stand with me this morning, if you're inside this building and just in the reverence of the Word of God, the reading of the Word of God. Verse 53, going on through 8:11. Says they went each to his own house, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning, he came again to the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery, and placing her in the midst, they said to him, teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now, in the law of Moses, it commanded us to stone such women. So what do you say? They said this to test him, that he might have some charge to bring against him. And Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. As they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And once more he bent down and wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." Let us pray. Father, we hear your words. Lord, may your words penetrate our hearts. Lord, we give you this time, Lord, to say, here we are, Lord, use us, speak to us, mold us, shape us, convict us, heal us. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. So there we have the context. Jesus, after the speaking there at the temple the next day, he spends the night in the Mount of Olives, and he comes down to the temple, and it's there. It says actually there in verse 2, early in the morning he came again to the temple, and all the people came to him. So they're having an early morning Bible study. the breaking down of the booths is taking place. It's kind of the end of the festival. Things are wrapping up. And so he comes to the temple early in the morning, and a crowd automatically begins to form around him. He begins to teach the people. And as he's teaching, what takes place? Verse 3, the scribes and Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery and placed her in his midst. And then they asked him a question. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery." Verse 5, "Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. What do you say?" They said this to test him, that they might have some charges to bring against him. So they're trying to trap Jesus, right? They couldn't arrest him. And even the scriptures say that even if they wanted to, they couldn't, because his time had not yet come. And so here they are, they're gathering around Jesus. They've caught this woman in the act of adultery, and they're bringing her before Jesus. Now, there again, this is early in the morning. And just like a lot of situations, remember, the people of Israel are not all good. People of Israel, people are people. People are sinful. And they come to Jerusalem to have a worship of God and a wonderful celebration. And usually by the end of the week, it begins to deteriorate, and things like this are taking place. Too much wine, a lot of women, right? And so a lot of things are taking place that should not take place. Sort of like, we don't even think about this because we're kind of removed from it. Mardi Gras is a religious holiday. Now, when you think of Mardi Gras, you don't think of religion, do you? No, you think of all the things that take place in New Orleans and other places, of just all the hedonism that takes place. There again, kind of the same situation. So it was not hard to find a woman being caught in the act of adultery. They're out in booths. They're living in booths. These things are taking place. They obviously know this woman. They probably knew where they could find her. They bring her to Jesus and put her at his feet. Cast her down there. There she is, exposed, most likely naked or half naked, standing there before a crowd, embarrassed, just broken. Well, Leviticus chapter 20, verse 10, and Deuteronomy 22, 22 talk about this stoning of those who are caught in the act of adultery. Now, so they're right in the fact that the law of Moses says that. But there's also some other aspects of the law. Well, you think of this, of David. Remember David, King David, who committed adultery and also committed murder, but yet he was not stoned. Why is that? Well, the Bible does give us some opportunity for forgiveness. There's a guilt offering and there's a sin offering. These things are to be offered up unto the Lord. If you read Psalm 51, you see the confession and repentance of David. That's all of what Psalm 51 is. He recognizes his sin before the Lord. He comes to the Lord for forgiveness. There again, this stoning aspect is for those who are unrepentant. Those who just thumb their nose and say, you know, get out of my private life. What happens in my bedroom is my business, it's none of your business. Well, for those there again who are going against the law of God, who are unrepentant, they are to be stoned. We know this is not a true concern for these Pharisees, because for one thing, it says both in Leviticus and in Deuteronomy that the man and the woman are to be brought before. We see just the woman is there. Where's the man? Where's the guy? He's not here. They don't really want justice. They don't really want the law of God to be applied. They're just trying to trap Jesus in a situation. So what is the trap? Well, if he just excuses her sin, well, he's seen as breaking God's law and has no regard for the law of Moses. They can say, this man is not of God. Look at that. He just tells her, you know, don't worry about it. You know, just try to do good. Just try to be a good girl. And just kind of go away. Well, they can accuse him of being soft on the law and saying, this is not a man of God. Otherwise, he would know the law of God and know that we must stone this woman. Well, the other side of that is the fact that he does have her stoned. Remember, who are the people that are coming to him? It's people that see Jesus as a friend of sinners. Most likely the crowd that was there that was gathering were tax collectors and drunkards and prostitutes and people of ill regard. And so all these people are gathering around Jesus, that he is the friend of sinners who's come to confront the Pharisees and scribes. A matter of fact, in one of their holiest weeks and at a time that is pivotal, Jesus says, "Come to me and drink." They're saying, "I'm thirsty. I'm living a life that has caused me to hunger and thirst for the things of this world, and I'm never satisfied. But here's one who says he has the water of life, the bread of life." And so most likely, a large part of the crowd that was gathered were those who would be considered sinners. And so if he has her stoned, he says, "Yep, you got me. I'm sorry, lady, but you did the sin. Now you got to do the punishment." And allowed her to be stoned. Really, two things take place. He loses all of his credibility with the crowd. But the second thing is that they could actually have him arrested, because under Roman law, a Jewish citizen, even rabbi or priest or chief priest, could not give the execution orders to anyone. And the Romans could come in and say, "Who are you? You're no lawyer, you're no judge, you're no Roman centurion, Roman executive. You have no authorization to condemn someone to death." And so really, it's kind of a sticky situation, if you will, as we look at the whole situation that's taking place. So what does Jesus do? It says there in the second part of verse 6, Jesus bent down and he wrote with his finger on the ground. He wrote with his finger on the ground. So what did he write? That's the big question. You look at the commentators, they're all over the map. I tend to believe and kind of go into the camp with some of them. And really, in the big scheme of things, it doesn't really matter. But I believe maybe some kind of, to help us understand the situation, maybe it help us understand Scripture. I believe it was one of the things it could have been is the fulfillment of a prophecy, Jeremiah 17:13. Jeremiah 17:13 says, "O Lord, the hope of all Israel, all who forsake you shall be put to shame. Those who turn away from you, their names shall be written in the earth, for they have forsaken the Lord, the fountain of living water." Maybe it's a prophetic fulfillment of that writing their names in the earth, writing the names of the people who had brought this young lady to them. Those are most likely just four or five people. It wasn't a big crowd. The crowd was the people listening to Jesus. The small entourage was the one who brought the lady. So I think, and there again, I could be wrong, and that's okay. You don't have to agree with me. But I believe maybe he was writing their names there in the ground. And he wasn't responding to them, and that really made them frustrated. The tension is building, if you will. They've brought this woman, there she is, all exposed, and they've brought the accusation, they've brought the law, and here we say, here it is. Now what are you going to do? And Jesus kind of seems to ignore them, but he's scribbling in the sand. And verse 7 says, as they continued to ask him, so they're asking him over, and hey, what are you going to do? He stood up and he said to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. Very, very great comeback, if you will. I mean, we look at that, and sometimes we even use that, hey, you know, you need to be, you know, if you have no sin, you cast the first stone. And there's truth to that. But it goes deeper than that. Jesus really does something really unique here. He really turns the law on them. They come to him with the law. And Scripture says this over and over. If you want the law, be careful, because when you get the law, you may not get the law that you want. If you're going to try to live by the law, then you're going to die by the law. And Jesus, he's offering grace, but they want the law. And so what does he do? He says to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. Now, the law says that the witnesses must cast the first stone. So they had to have seen her committing the act of adultery. There again, not too hard when you're living in a booth or a tent outside. But here's the catch. As a part of that law, the witness itself, so the one who is the witness or the multiple witnesses, they are the ones who can cast the first stone. But here's the catch. You also must be innocent of the same crime. So in essence, if you really look at the Greek, is what he's saying here. He says, let him who is without this sin cast the first stone. I mean, he really caught him. I believe this kind of, there again, goes back to that Jeremiah 17:13. What is he writing? I believe Jesus, and this is just my educated guess, he's writing their names, their adulterous ladies, maybe even a date or a notation, the Seaside Inn, January 17th, the Hilltop View Resort, December 23rd. And so here he is, he's saying, look, you guys who are bringing the accusation, whichever one of you have not committed adultery, not necessarily with her, but if you yourself have not committed this sin, according to the law, only that person can cast a stone. And I believe the evidence of their sin, of their adultery, was written right there in the sand. And what they do, they begin to turn from the older ones. I think they realized the gig is up. We've been caught. We need to hurry up and get out of here so he will erase this before my wife comes by. We need to get out of here. They begin to leave one by one by one. And so when they heard it, they went away. And verse 10, Jesus stood up and said to her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? She said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go. From now on, sin no more. In the next few minutes, we're just going to look at that phrase, that those words of Jesus there in verse 11. That is going to be our outline. Jesus gives it to her. The scribes and Pharisees, they came with the law. And they wanted Jesus to give her the law. What does Jesus give to her? We see what could have been versus what was. So Jesus gives it to her. Point number one, Jesus gives grace. Jesus gives her grace. He says, neither do I condemn you. Now we have to look at this passage and see what's going on here. This passage has been twisted and turned by however people want to interpret it, but we got to look at Scripture and see it for what it is. He says, I do not condemn you. What does it mean to condemn? It means there's no hope. There's no hope of correction. There's no hope of repair. There's no hope of alteration. In other words, if you condemn someone to life in prison, you're saying there is no hope for parole. You're going to spend the rest of your life in prison. You have been condemned in your sentence. If you condemn a building, that means there's no hope of repair or future usefulness. It is beyond all hope. It is too far gone. It must just be demolished. When Jesus looks at her and he says, I do not condemn you. And she's saying, I'm not saying there's no hope for you. He does not condemn her to say, there's no hope, there's nothing you can do, you're wasted, you used your life for nothing, except for your own pleasure, breaking up families, you did all this, there's no hope for you, get away from me. No, he says, I do not condemn you. I do not condemn you. Jesus does not condemn her, but he also does not condone her lifestyle. He does not condone her sin. What does he do? See, the Pharisees thought, oh, there's only two options. He can either condemn her to death or he can condone her sin. Those are the only two options. Well, they forgot something. Jesus is not just a guy. He's not just a preacher. He's the Son of the living God. He is God himself. And so what does God do? He forgives her. That option was not part of their plan, either condemnation or condoning. One of the two. But Jesus gives the third option. He forgives her. He forgives her. It's a radical thought. And sometimes we look at this passage and it's okay. It's neat and tidy. It seems that way. Woman caught in adultery, we feel sorry for her. She's there. She's exposed. And we see the frailness of a woman caught in adultery who's been exposed. And we sympathize with her. And we should. And Jesus does, obviously. But here's the thing is that maybe if you put a different character in its place, we begin to see more of ourselves as those of holding stones rather than seeing the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. What if it was a man who was caught in the act of homosexuality? And Jesus would look at him or her, say, neither do I condemn you. I don't condone your sin, but I don't condemn you. See, Jesus is referring back to John chapter 3. Turn back to John chapter 3. I believe Jesus may have had more of a conversation with her, but John, in the attempt to save pen and ink, knows that he's already told us about one event. John chapter 3, verse 17. In John chapter 3, verse 17, it says, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. We see that. That's exactly what's taking place. He did not come to condemn. That's what Jesus says to her. I didn't come to condemn you. I'm not condemning you. I'm not saying you're worthless. I'm not saying you're hopeless. I'm not saying you're too far gone. Because it says here in verse 18, John 3:18, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already. And Jesus said, look, your sins have already condemned you. You have that law of Moses that the Pharisees want to take in their hands and go running around the streets with. You have that law. You know that the adultery is sin. You know that homosexuality is sin. You know that gossiping is sin. Whatever that sin in your life is, you know it's sin. And it has already condemned you. Unconfessed and unrepented and undealt with, you will die in your sins. Condemned to hell. That's the reality. You're already there. That ticket has already been purchased. Your sin purchased your ticket and your condemnation. And Jesus says, I'm not here to heap on top of that. There's coming a day of judgment, and you will stand before him. You're going to stand before Jesus. This woman will one day stand before Jesus, and here's the opportunity now in this life to seek forgiveness. He comes to her, or she comes to him. She's brought to him. And what does Jesus give her? He gives her grace. Her sins have already condemned her. Condemnation is awaiting unless she grabs hold of Jesus. There again, we can be like the Pharisees and begin to decry certain people and certain actions and certain things. And of course they're sinful. Of course they're against the things of God. That's why they're called sin. That's why the world is called the world. One of the things that we see is the grace of Jesus Christ, and sometimes we overlook the grace. Matter of fact, in the song we sung first, to God be the glory. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood. To every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus, a pardon receives. The vilest offender. This week, there's been some Jerry Falwell Jr., all the things that have been exposed about that whole situation. I mean, it's horrible. It's ungodly, uncharacteristic of what you would call a pastor and someone who would be an ordained minister and a leader of a Christian university. Absolutely ungodly. But Jesus even looks at them and says, neither do I condemn you. Now, that doesn't mean that they should be put back into place, and just because he asked for forgiveness, he should pastor church. I mean, there are certain things. I mean, really, Jerry Falwell Jr. and his wife, the next phrase you should hear out of them is, would you like to supersize that? I mean, no place in the church, no place in leadership they should ever be eligible for. Again, there are certain things that you do that there's a price that comes with that. As Jesus sat there on the cross with two thieves beside him, he told the one who placed his faith in Jesus, today you will be with me in paradise. But Jesus did not say, now come down from the cross. It's okay that you did some crime. No, they had to pay the price. The thief on the cross had to die for the penalty of his crime. But Jesus saved his soul. The world condemned his body. Jesus saved his soul. So we see that. There's a price sometimes to be paid. We don't have the full story of this woman and what took place after she went home. But we see that Jesus gives her the hope of grace. Neither do I condemn you. Point number two, Jesus says go. Neither do I condemn you. And the second thing is he gives her life. Tells her to go. Jesus gives life. He gives grace, and then he gives life. He tells her to go. He's saying, I'm giving you life. Go. I mean, as she's standing there, as she's sitting there, she knows she's been caught. And under the law of Moses, there should be a stoning taking place. But Jesus drives away her accusers, and he's left with there, and he tells her, go. In a sense, what he's saying is, go, live. Live. Now, here's the thing, is that according to the law of Moses, you had to have at least two witnesses. Jesus is the only one that's standing there, and he's the only one who truly knows all. He knows that he could be the only witness. He's saying, look, there's no more witnesses. Case dismissed. It's been a mistrial. You can go. What seemed like a death sentence just a few moments earlier is now her freedom to go. Jesus says, I don't condemn you. Not just saying that, hasn't talked about her sin yet. I do not condemn you. Now go. See, this has been a major theme in the book of John. You don't have to turn to these scriptures. I have them written down. Just listen to this. John chapter 5, verse 21. For as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom He will. John 5, 24. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes Him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but is passed from death to life. In John chapter 5, verse 40, He says, you refuse to come to me that you may have life. John 6, 33, for the bread of God is He who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. John 6, 51, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of this world is my flesh. See what Jesus is saying? He's saying, look, your sins have condemned you. But I want to give you life. So therefore, I myself will not condemn you. The ultimate judge will not condemn you. I'm going to give you life. He is the fulfillment of all these scriptures. He's giving life over and over and over again. He's saying, come to me, I am the life. Do we see this? That in our sins, we are condemned to death. Only in Jesus Christ do we have life. Jesus is the one. He's the one who gives us the life, not only the eternal life, but the current life. To live life in abundance, to truly live in the open, to live in the light and say, here I am. I mean, here's the thing is that these acts took place in tucked away places. They took place at night. They took place in alleys and corners and away from the open view. Why? Because they know that it's sin and we live our lives that way. We love to sin in the alleys and in the corners and in the dark rooms. And then when we're brought to the light, we want to scurry like roaches. But in the light, everything is exposed. You see the truth of who Jesus is. You see the work that He has done on the cross. You say, I want to live in that light. I'm tired of living in the shadows. I want to live in where I can walk and say, look, I'm free. I've been given life. I can live in the open with Jesus. See, it says there, Jesus said in John 6, 51, that He says, and the bread that I will give for this life, for the life of the world, is my flesh. Jesus gave His life for our sins, so that we can have life through Him and through His work on the cross. 2 Corinthians 5, 21 tells us that. For our sake, for sinners like you and me, for our sake, He made Him, Jesus, to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in Him we might have become the righteousness of God. Notice that Jesus didn't just take on our sins. It said it made Him to be sin. See, here's the reason why Jesus can say, I don't condemn you. Here's the reason why. Because as He looks at her, and He knows her sin, He can say, I forgive you, because He dies for her sin. The act that she was committing just moments before, Jesus, in a few weeks, will go to a cross for that sin. And He will become her sin. He is the only one that can cleanse of that sin. He's the only one that can forgive of that sin, because He Himself takes on that sin. Not just figuratively or representatively, but literally. He becomes sin. For our sake, He says, go. I give you life. I'm here to bring life. Go. And the third thing is this, He gives Himself. He gives Himself, He says, and from now on, sin no more. From now on, sin no more. There again, Jesus is now dealing with her sin. He's dealing with the reality of her sin. He's dealt with the reality of her soul. I don't condemn you. Now go. I'm going to give you life. I'm not saying you're hopeless or beyond hope. I'm going to go to this cross for this sin. I want you to go and I want you to have life. But life comes through faith in Jesus. He says, go and from now on, sin no more. Now, that's kind of a tall order. I mean, you know, I don't know anyone that's kept up with that promise or that phrase, right? I mean, that's the, you know. He's like, well, Jesus, that's easy to say for you, right? I mean, you know, you're the sinless one. But you're telling this woman, you're telling me to go and sin no more. What are you saying? There's got to be more to the story here. There's got to be more to the situation. Because, I mean, I can just imagine in my mind that this woman is, she's excited that Jesus is saying, go, I'm not going to condemn you, you're going to live. And he says, oh, and as she's walking away saying, thank you, and then he says, oh, by the way, go and sin no more. I can just imagine it stopping her in her tracks going, wait, what? Everything was going great until this point, Jesus. Because even if I don't never commit adultery again, there's going to be other things. So will it be retroactive that I could come back here for a stoning or what? How does this work? How does this play out? Here's what Jesus is saying. Turn to 1 John. Turn to 1 John. It's in the back of your Bible just before Revelation. You have a few Johns, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Jude, then Revelation. It says toward the back, written by the same person, same John. John is going to speak about this. I believe John, in his older days, when he writes the letter of 1 John, I believe he's reflecting back on his gospel that he wrote, the Gospel of John. And I believe he's so much sticking into to this narrative. I believe that he's answering the parts of the narrative that we don't get the answer, that we don't have the end of. What happens to this woman? Jesus tells her, go on and sin no more. And so I believe John is coming back later in life, and he's beginning to write. He's like, let me fill in some blanks of some things in the past that I wrote. 1 John chapter 1, beginning in verse 5. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light. Now just hold right there for a second, because next week, here's the message for next week. Verse 12 of chapter 8. Remember, we're only doing verses 1 through 11. Verse 12, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. As the woman begins to walk away and Jesus tells her, go and from now on sin no more, and he turns to the crowd and says, I'm the light of the world. I'm the light of the world. Now that's next week's sermon. But how does that fit into what Jesus is doing here? Look again, verse 5. This is the message, 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. This is the message we've heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. This woman was caught in darkness and brought to the light. Verse 6, if we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. What is John saying in this letter? He's saying when Jesus says, go and sin no more, here's the expectation. He's not saying, go get away from me, sin no more. He's saying, go live your life, but live your life with me. Come be with me. Come walk with me. Come stay in the light with me. Because why? Because 1 John tells us that what? Verse 6, if we say we have fellowship. Ah, fellowship with him. So verse 6 tells us, as if we say we have fellowship, that gives us by logical conclusion that we can have fellowship with him. There's a way to have fellowship with Jesus. Not just a long-distance relationship, but an intimate one-on-one relationship with the living God, whose name is Jesus Christ. And he says, go and sin no more. What is he saying? Stick with me. Stick with me. I've not condemned you. I've not called you hopeless. I've given you life. Now, as you live that life, live it with me. See, here's the thing. You go on State Road 26 out of Trenton, heading to Gainesville on a Monday morning, say about 6, between the hours of 6 and 7 a.m. If you're not doing 80 miles an hour, you're going to get slap run over, right? I mean, you'll get passed in no passing zones on hills, and it's amazing there's not one death a day on State Road 26. But you line State Road 26 with highway patrolmen, guess what? Everybody's nice and obeying the law, and nobody's putting on makeup on their way to work, right? Why? Because there's someone there that is exposing the light of the law, the light of truth. You drive differently with the law person behind you than you do if they're not. Am I right? That's what Jesus is saying. You hang with me. Not that you're in fear of me, but Jesus is light. And when you're in the light and you have fellowship with the light, the darkness is seen as a no-go zone. I don't want to go into the dark. Why? Because I have Jesus. I have the light. Life is so much better in the light. Why would I want to go to the darkness? So walk in fellowship with him is what he says. Verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie. In other words, you can't do that. You can't have fellowship with Jesus and walk in darkness. That's just the reality. There again, you know, when we talk about certain things, and there's just certain things in the reality of the church that we're having to deal with, and one of those things is the aspect of homosexuality. I brought that up earlier as an illustration, and that's the reality. Jesus will forgive. But here's the thing, is that Jesus does not say, go and live that life as a Christian. He says, if you want to walk in with me in fellowship, you got to be in the light with me. I do not condemn you of your homosexuality, but you go and be forgiven, seek forgiveness, and live in the light with me. There's got to be a change. There is no walking with Jesus and still living in a life of adultery. He does not tell that woman this. He does not say, go live your life as whatever your sin is and my sin is. We can talk about other people's sin all day long, but I need to deal with my sin. I cannot live actively involved in my sin and just go, meh, it's okay. Jesus didn't condemn her. He won't condemn me. It's not the reality. The reality is Jesus says, go and sin no more. Come and live in the light with me. And we're going to hurry up and get through this. It says verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, that was giving up that life of sin, of adultery, of homosexuality, whatever sin it is, we have fellowship with one another, the church and Christ, and the blood of Jesus, his son, listen to this, cleanses us of all sin. That's how you can live with sin no more. That's it right there. I mean, in and of yourself, saying, you, Chuck Scott, you sin no more. I can't do that. I can't make that promise. But I can walk in the light of Jesus Christ and have fellowship with him. And when I do sin, I seek out his blood. It says there in verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. Verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. There's a confession. To truly confess your sins means to not just be sorry for getting caught. It means to be sorry for breaking the heart of God. To truly be repentant and say, God, I have offended you. Forgive me. I'm going to change. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm still going to mess up. But whatever it is, I'm done with that. I've been given life. I was condemned by my sins, but Jesus says, I don't condemn you. Live. Go. But as you live your life, don't try to do it self-righteously. Don't try to do it just by being better than your neighbor. Don't try to do it by just being better than others. That's the Pharisees. You live your life with me. With me. And I will change you. I'm going to change you. I'm not going to let you live in your old sins. I'm not going to let you be defined that way. That's not life. It's not living in the light. There's no gift in that. That's condemnation. Jesus, I want to give you life. Life with me. And Jesus gives it to her. He gives it to you and to me. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this gift of life that you've given to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, if we confess of our sins, you faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. Lord, that faithful means that you will do it every time, and the just means that you paid the penalty for it. You're not just giving lip service. You are just to forgive sins. You have paid the price on the cross. Lord, may we come to you for that forgiveness. Lord, may we live our lives in the light. Lord, may we confess our sins to you and be cleansed by your shed blood, that we can walk in the light of your love. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We have a time of invitation here. We're going to sing a song. If you would stand with me as we sing, You Are My King, hymn number 305. You may just want to take this opportunity to pray. The altar is open. It's available. I'll be available up front. And wherever you're sitting, wherever you are, in your car, on the video, at home, wherever it is, take this as an opportunity to take just a minute to either sing or to pray, to reflect on the Word of God, whatever it is, however the Holy Spirit leads you this morning as we have this time of invitation. You Are My King, Amazing Love.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love. How that you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Just keep that slide up there for just a moment, Kevin. As we look at those words, amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you, and all I do, I honor you. That's the fulfillment of that passage. That, Lord, because of your amazing love, what else could I do? What else could I do because of your amazing love? And I know it's true. What else could I do but live my life to honor you? Y'all, there's a world that needs to hear that message, and we have that message of this amazing love that is found in Jesus Christ, who does not condemn. He doesn't condone, but he doesn't condemn. He gives life. And then he says, come be with me. Don't just go live your life on your own and try to figure it out. Come and live in the light with me. That's an amazing love. Because of that, it's our joy to honor him in all that we do. And so I encourage you to take that message. Y'all, there's a message that, of the world that needs to hear that. They think the church is filled with people that are the Pharisees that have hands full of rocks ready to cast them. And we need to instead bring them to the hand of Jesus Christ that is full of grace and love and mercy. Say, listen, I'm a sinner too, and I can't condemn you, and Jesus doesn't condemn you. Your sins have condemned you already, but let me tell you the one who has the answer, the one who has the love and the grace and the mercy to change your life. May that be our message, and that may be the way that we communicate on Facebook or whatever social media platform you have, and at your workplaces and your families, whatever it is, your neighborhoods, that we have people that are talking about the amazing love of Jesus. What could have been versus what was. My life, that's the testimony of your life if you're a Christian. What could have been versus what was. Let me pray for us, and then we'll have our departing hymn this morning. Father, we thank you for this amazing love. Lord, may you just lay it on our hearts and continue to speak to our hearts as we go about our business the rest of this day and this week. Lord, as we would live our lives in light of your amazing love, of your grace, and Lord, of the life that you've given to us. May we live in the light. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Our departing hymn this morning is, To God Be the Glory.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
You're dismissed.